Welcome to Grace Digital Presentation. In this video, we shall be discussing learning to depend on God. What do you think is the greatest lesson God wants us to learn as we go through our waiting season? At those times when it looks as if we have been waiting in faith quite patiently for His words to come to pass, there is a priceless lesson to pick up in that stage that can become such a valuable part of our life as we forge ahead in life. God's plan for us is to learn how to depend on Him, because it is in moments like these that we realize the fact that God alone is our greatest need, our solid rock, and the wind beneath our sail. Psalm 62, 7-8. My salvation and my honor depend on God. He is my mighty rock, my refuge. Trust in Him at all times. You people, pour out your hearts to Him, for God is our refuge. A perfect example of learning how to depend on God is revealed to us in 2 Kings chapter 18. You say you have the counsel and the might for war, but you speak only empty words. On whom are you depending that you rebel against me? Look, I know you are depending on Egypt, that splintered reed of a staff, which pierces the hand of anyone who leans on it. Such is Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to all who depend on him. But if you say to me, we are depending on the Lord our God, is it He the one whose high places and altars Hezekiah removed, saying to Judah and Jerusalem, you must worship before this altar in Jerusalem? Come now, make a bargain with my master, the king of Assyria. I will give you 2,000 horses if you can put riders on them. Do not listen to Hezekiah. This is what the king of Assyria says, make peace with me and come out to me. Then each of you will eat fruit from your own vine and fig tree and drink water from your own cistern, until I come and take you to a land like your own, a land of grain and new wine, a land of bread and vineyards, a land of olive trees and honey. Choose life, not death. Do not listen to Hezekiah, for he is misleading you when he says, the Lord will deliver us. Has the God of any nation ever delivered his land from the hand of the king of Assyria? Where are the gods of Hamath and Arpad? Where are the gods of Sepharvaim, Hena and Eva? Have they rescued Samaria from my hand? Who of all the gods of these countries has been able to save his land from me? How then can the Lord deliver Jerusalem from my hand? But the people remained silent and said nothing in reply, because the king had commanded, do not answer him. The adversary simply wanted their dependence in God gone, and even though it was Assyria that was taunting them, it really was just the devil behind the scene trying to steal their unshakable trust in God, so as to steal their sure victory. 2 Kings chapter 19. Then Isaiah son of Amos sent a message to Hezekiah. This is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. I have heard your praying concerning Sennacherib, king of Assyria. Who is it you have ridiculed and blasphemed? Against whom have you raised your voice and lifted your eyes in pride? Against the Holy One of Israel. Have you not heard? Long ago I ordained it. In days of old I planned it. Now I have brought it to pass that you have turned fortified cities into piles of stone. Their people drained of power are dismayed and put to shame. They are like plants in the field, like tender green shoots, like grass sprouting on the roof, scorched before it grows up. But I know where you are and when you come and go and how you rage against me. Therefore, this is what the Lord says concerning the king of Assyria. He will not enter the city or shoot an arrow here. He will not come before it with shield or build a siege ramp against it. By the way that he came, he will return. He will not enter the city, declares the Lord. I will defend this city and save it for my sake and for the sake of David, my servant. God loved the fact that his people did not see men as their source or fear their threats. Throughout the time of these tireless taunts, a strong new character was being formed in God's people, a resilience that not even taunts, mockery, or threats could shake. That is the firm attitude that defines us as God's children. We are reminded of a saying that God is more concerned about who you are becoming rather than what you are having. Yes, He wants us to have victory and see His words become a reality in our lives, but much more than that, He wants us to develop an attitude of total dependence on Him, not people, things, or systems of the world. However, when we choose to walk out on God's process of molding us, do things our way and look solely to people instead of depending on God, we end up losing everything, even our own sanity in the long run. Isaiah 30, 12-18. Therefore, this is what the Holy One of Israel says. Because you have rejected this message, relied on oppression, and depended on deceit, this sin will become for you like a high wall, cracked and bulging, that collapses suddenly in an instant. It will break in pieces like pottery, shattered so mercilessly that among its pieces, not a fragment will be found for taking coals from a hearth or scooping water out of a cistern. This is what the Sovereign Lord, the Holy One of Israel, says. In repentance and rest is your salvation. In quietness and trust is your strength. But you would have none of it. You said, "No, we will flee on horses." Therefore, you will flee. You said, "We will ride off on swift horses." Therefore, your pursuers will be swift. 1,000 will flee at the threat of one. At the threat of five, you will all flee away, till you are left like a flagstaff on a mountaintop, like a banner on a hill. Yet the Lord longs to be gracious to you. Therefore, he will rise up to show you compassion. For the Lord is a God of justice. Blessed are all who wait for him. In looking to people and depending on their opinions is nothing but regrets. For we were made to lean on the Creator and not to feed on the opinion of his creatures. Psalm 34:4-5. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look at him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. It's also important to realize that the problem isn't just looking to people for their power, wealth, or connections instead of looking at God. The problem is also looking at ourselves. This includes depending on our own skills, abilities, knowledge, connections, or finances to get us through hard times. Hosea 10:13. But you have planted wickedness, you have reaped evil, you have eaten the fruit of deception, because you have depended on your own strength and on your many warriors. This is why whenever we are in the place of faith and holding on to a particular scripture to manifest, God demands that we are patient and that we rest in his love. He takes this time to prune our hearts and work on us from inside out, till we get to the point where nothing else matters but our need and dependence on him alone. Not people, things, or a backup source, or help, but just him. If we are able to learn this lesson of absolute dependence on God, then we have passed the test of faithfulness, and we can trust that God will always see us as channels of everything he has down the road, whether it be his wisdom, his wealth, or even the destiny of the other members of his family. A chapter in the Bible that also shows that God forms the attitude of dependence in his people during their season of waiting is Deuteronomy chapter 8. Be careful to follow every command I am giving you today, so that you may live and increase and may enter and possess the land the Lord promised on oath to your ancestors. Remember how the Lord your God led you all the way in the wilderness these 40 years, to humble and test you in order to know what was in your heart, whether or not you would keep his commands. He humbled you, causing you to hunger, and then feeding you with manna, which neither you nor your ancestors had known, to teach you that man does not live on bread alone, but on every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothes did not wear out, and your feet did not swell during those 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, so the Lord your God disciplines you. Observe the commands of the Lord your God, walking in obedience to him and revering him. For the Lord your God is bringing you into a good land, a land with brooks, streams, and deep springs gushing out into the valleys and hills, a land with wheat and barley, vines and fig trees, pomegranates, olive oil, and honey, a land where bread will not be scarce and you will lack nothing, a land where the rocks are iron and you can dig copper out of the hills. When you have eaten and are satisfied, praise the Lord your God for the good lands he has given you. Be careful that you do not forget the Lord your God, failing to observe his commands, his laws, and his decrees that I am giving you this day. Otherwise, when you eat and are satisfied, when you build fine houses and settle down, and when your herds and flocks grow large, and your silver and gold increase, and all you have is multiplied, then your heart will become proud, and you will forget the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. He led you through the vast and dreadful wilderness, that thirsty and waterless land, with its venomous snakes and scorpions. He brought you water out of hard rock. He gave you manna to eat in the wilderness, something your ancestors had never known, to humble and test you, so that in the end it might go well with you. You may say to yourself, "My power and the strength of my hands have produced this wealth for me." But remember the Lord your God, for it is He who gives you the ability to produce wealth, and so confirms His covenant, which He swore to your ancestors as it is today. If you ever forget the Lord your God and follow other gods and worship and bow down to them, I testify against you today that you will surely be destroyed. The reason why God fed them with manna in the wilderness, even though in the promised land there would be so much more, was so that they could learn to depend on Him and His words daily. If in their most trying times they were able to develop that nature of dependence on God, for man can't live by bread alone, then they would learn never to forget Him in the place of their ease, rest, and fruitfulness. The reason why many forget God easily and fall into perdition when all is rosy is because when they are facing challenges and praying for a change, they didn't pick up this most valuable lesson of dependence on God. For if a man truly understands that God has been his never-failing anchor, even in the days when things looked hopeless, how then can he throw away the counsel of that same God when things are easy? Let us pray. Thank you, Father, for being my never-failing rock and the source of my help when things are hard or when they are rosy. Thank you for teaching me about the priceless virtue of depending on you in my challenging season. And thank you because this lesson will help me to scale great heights. In Jesus' name, I will never fall or fail in life's journey. Amen.